Good morning, everyone. I will call the meeting to order at 8:34 a.m. First thing, if we could do a roll call.
Good morning.
Just before we begin, if I could just do the virtual meeting statement.
Yes, Andrew, thank you.
Sure. This meeting is being held in accordance with the resolution 2020-16. Of the City of Coral Springs. The proceeding is conducted utilizing communications media technology and will be conducted using the Zoom video communications. Now, due to the ongoing state of emergency and the recommendations from all public health authorities, the City of Coral Springs recommends that all persons you can participate in the meeting through electronic means. I believe today we are broadcasting over TV, and the meeting can be viewed on City TV, Blue Stream Channel 725, 25, 25.7. And if it is working, I'm not sure if it is, ATTU verse channel 99, and online at www.coralsprings.org/citytv. For those individuals who may not have access to view or participate, you can always go to 9500 West Sample Road, Coral Springs, Florida, 33065. That's the Coral Springs Municipal Complex. There's an iPad outside for you to listen and participate during public comment. If you plan to attend, please practice social distancing and do not stand closer than 6 feet to those around you. And please also wear your facial covering in accordance with CDC guidelines. Public comment will be received by phone and email. The local call in number is 954-344-5900. You can submit it online as well. Additionally, for today, those outside at City Hall can go up to the iPad and give public comment.
Thank you, Andrew. Okay, let's do a roll call quick.
Okay, this is Anne Marie. I'll go ahead. Anna Van Helden?
Here, thank you.
Maria Minoli?
She Maria is here. She stepped away.
Oh, okay. Bradley Hubert?
Here.
Philip Balaam?
Present.
Ray Lefevre?
Here.
Larry Vignola.
Present.
Dr. Paceras.
She is not here.
Okay. Melissa Heller.
Good morning.
Good morning. Gary Springer.
Here.
Andrew Dunkel.
Here.
Chelsea Stahl.
Present.
Rita Weaver.
Here.
Jessica Coyne.
Here.
Amy Weisbaum.
Here.
Okay, I think that's it.
Yeah, yes. Thank you. Can I get a motion to approve minutes from our last meeting?
To avail motions for acceptance of the meeting minutes?
Thank you, Phil. Can I get a second?
I'll second it.
Thank you, Brad. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Pass unanimously. Moving on to public comments. Do we have any public comments outside on iPad or on the phone? If we don't, moving on to the CSUSA reports. Gary?
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much. It's great to see some of you on here. I know some of you are camera shy, which is absolutely fine. Some of you that have not seen me in a while, you definitely have not seen me smiling to this level in probably 7 months with regards to when we talk about Coral Springs Charter School, but I'm at the point where it's really awesome. The fact that we welcomed back some of our students yesterday in grades 6 and 9, and then tomorrow we will be welcoming back all grade levels of those students that have chosen, those families that have chosen for their children to return to campus. And we're just really excited, quite honestly. It's just been an awesome feeling. It added life instantly into this building, something that was very much missed. And quite honestly, nothing in a virtual format. It's just surely impossible. Just as it is right now with all of you, how much greater the emotion is and the ability to kind of interact with all of you when we ultimately, hopefully, are back in person for some of these meetings. In the interim, usually I'd be talking about all kinds of other things going on an annual basis with regards to athletics and drama and, you know, chorus and all of that. Sadly, there's nothing to really report with that respect. But as far as us getting things and kicking it off and, you know, intentionally, methodically working through the processes here of making sure that we have a quality experience for our students, I'm not naive enough to know that we're going to have some hiccups over the next few weeks, absolutely, as our teachers now go from, you know, mobile only, you know, with regards to the students in a remote format to having in a dual format with students on campus and remote. But I do know, and I have faith that they're going to do a great job. You know, our theme this year is to be great. So with that said, there's so many other things in effect. I believe last meeting I shared with you all of that that took place for the heavy lift to occur for us to get to this point. I do want to thank Charter Schools USA for all of their assistance, obviously, as a part of Charter Schools USA for the past 18, 19, I think it's 19 years now. I'm very proud to work with an organization that is committed to, you know, making sure that we provide and put forth a high quality education for our students. And in particular, as one of our flagship schools, making sure that we've continued on the path of excellence with regards to academic excellence and safety and security. And also our partnership with the city of Coral Springs. I'd be remiss if I did not, you know, fold in Melissa into this. And obviously the oversight of our governing board as well. But with Melissa and Chelsea on this call and their guidance, I've gotten to know Melissa much more personally than either of us could have ever expected, because we've gone back and forth with emails and calls and everything else. Because, you know, on her end and my end, we wanna get it right. And we wanna continue to get it right. So we're doing that. We're looking forward to moving forward and getting going. The next choice date, just if you're ever asked for parents and families to weigh in on whether or not they wish to choose to send their children back to Coral Springs Charter School, will be an opportunity to choose the week before Thanksgiving, and then with the intent that the child will return on November 30th. Thereafter, we'll most likely, from the seat that I'm in, at a minimum, be in the mobile format or still offering the mobile format for the first semester. Second marking period actually begins next week. First mark, believe it or not, we just are locking down and finishing up the first marking period. That is the principal's report. If you have any questions, I would be glad to answer them, or I know I'm gonna present a few other things soon as well. Not going to be talkative today. Anna, you're on mute.
I have a question.
Yep.
So what's the discussion looking like for next semester with regards to providing the mobile learning? Still, I know the state, I heard they're having some conversations about funding where they might not fund for kids that are mobile. Can you give us an update on what's going on there?
Yeah, and so just as we don't have the update from the state, I think once a lot of that trickles down, we're still obviously having conversations. But, you know, most of those, we've got to take the lead in many instances, because aside from being accountable, you know, to the school board of Broward County and the district as their LEA, the state is obviously the end all be all as far as how we have to follow through with any direction. So, you know, we're just slowly but surely, I know our organization is working with individuals at the state level. And as the news comes out, I will update this board and the governing board. And not even necessarily when meetings occur, we may intermittently send out information. And I know Rita will be a part of that communication with the boards to inform all of you.
And what percentage of kids signed up to return?
38 overall. So that's varying in grade levels. but we were at around 38. It's, in some instances, a few may have stepped back from that choice, which is fine. We just weren't willing to do the reverse of that. We accommodated in the first, after the first couple of weeks to first few days. But aside from that, which is equal to five something as far as the numbers. And so that's what it's looking like overall. So our enrollment right now is 1685.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Any other questions for Gary? If not, I don't believe we have any financials, correct? Moving on to business. Gary also as well.
Okay, so this has already gone through and has been put before our governing board. As we've been obviously having some more frequent meetings to ensure, you know, in the COVID era here. But this is the Safe School Officer Attestation Form. And this is the first time I've actually said that correctly. But we are just seeking, Andrew, could you confirm or what specifically are we seeking to do on this?
I believe this already went to the governing board. Is that correct, Chelsea?
That's correct. Yeah, we're looking to ratify. What would have been a recommendation for them to approve.
It's just going to be to right. That's what you would be doing. I mean, generally these sort of things can just go to the governing board, but since you're looking at it, just know that the governing board signed an attestation that you know, there's a safe school officer, school resource officer. So this would just be a ratification and acknowledgement for recommendation to sign.
Okay, so can I get a motion to ratify the Safe School Officer Attestation Form?
Sure, Phil Bale, motions to ratify.
Second?
I'll second.
Brad, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you so much.
And so I believe for all of these documents, we are in a similar position. Okay. Correct me if I'm wrong real quick before we go through this.
The ESC, I think, is still needing to go before the governing board, but the other safety and security assurance would need to be ratified.
Okay. So in this instance, just a statement of insurance for exceptional student education that we are following through with and adhering to all of the policies set forth by the school board of Broward County and the state of Florida. And we're seeking a motion for, to my knowledge, a motion for this to be approved by the governing board. I don't know.
Okay. Can I get a motion, please, to forward the statement of assurance for exceptional student education to the governing board for a favorable approval?
Sure, Phil Bell recommends.
Second?
I'll second it.
Yeah, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Moving on to the safety and security assurances.
And this is just a opportunity to ratify here, a request to ratify that we have these safety and security requirements assurances in place. If you need me to discuss this document or talk about some of these items, I'll do so. Otherwise, this has been already put before our governing board and we're seeking ratification.
Okay, can I please get a motion to ratify the safety and security requirement assurances?
Phil Bell, I'll recommend.
Second?
I'll second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, passing on. Moving on to the advanced academic programming.
All right. So in this next instance, we're going to have a little presentation for you, but I'm just going to read a few things. I wanted to make sure I have it correct. I'm going to introduce somebody to talk to the board. I think this is great for you guys to be exposed to and understand where we stand on this. So this is a request, basically in conversations, a request of our governing board to extend dual enrollment offerings to fall and spring semesters and in potentially during the school day. So at the governing board meeting, it was agreed to follow protocol and present this to you for your recommendation should you see fit that this needs to be escalated to them. The school's position is to continue to provide us the flexibility to make these decisions that we as a leadership feel are in the best interest of the school and our students. We have carefully added courses throughout the years, as many of you know, and we continue to reflect on advanced offerings that will impact access and equity. So that's our big picture, and I'm just seeking the ability to continue along those lines. With that, though, I want to introduce Amy Weisbaum. She's the Director of Academic Support and Advanced Programming. She's been building up into this role, and this is a new role that we added or had already informed her that we were going to be adding in the middle of last year. So we wanted to stay, and we're well ahead of this because of all of the offerings that we do offer and making sure that we had somebody on top of this to really work with our students. So Amy is going to share her screen, to my knowledge. It is part of the board packet, but she'll share her screen so she can advance the slides as appropriate when she discusses them. She's not going to get into the minutia on a lot of this unless you say, Amy, please stop. I want to ask a question. But obviously, she'll also provide opportunities for some questions to be asked throughout the process. So with that, Amy, can you come on and share your slide deck?
Morning, everyone. Thank you so much for having me this morning to share the academic and advanced programs that we offer at Coral Springs Charter School. At the risk of sounding repetitive, can you see my screen?
Thumbs yes.
Up. Awesome. I'm going to go through, as Mr. Springer explained, some of the advanced programs that we offer at Coral Springs Charter School. If you have any specific questions, I'm happy to answer them. We're going to begin by speaking about advanced programming in general. State mandate says that we should be offering advanced programming to all of our students, and each graduate must have an accelerated point, which they can earn through Cambridge International, also called ACE, AP Advanced Placement, and Career and Technical Education, CTE. It is included in our school grade calculation when our students do take an advanced programming course and earn credit for that course. Currently, we offer 9 subjects in AP, 19 for Cambridge International or ACE. We have 7 pathways that our students can take for career and technology education. And we also offer opportunities for executive internships in addition to the dual enrollment options that we provide our students. So when speaking to Advanced Placement AP, which is run by College Board, this gives our students the opportunity to earn college credit while they are in high school. It means that if they take the class in high school and successfully earn an appropriate score, which is typically 3 and above on a scale of 1 to 5, they may be able to skip introductory courses at a college level. This is determined based on the college, and so some accept a score of 3 and some accept a score of 4 or 5. Students that take AP classes are more likely to enroll and stay in college and graduate in 4 years because they do have that edge of additional credits that they don't need to take. We currently offer the subjects listed on the screen, which includes 3 math classes, our government course, 3 art classes, and this year we've added chemistry and English literature and composition. By subject, last year and the previous school year, here are total pass rates. You can see that we have an incredibly high pass rate in our 2D art class and 100% in our drawing class. We also have seen great improvements in our calculus AB and BC programs. And here's just another visual for you to see of our pass rates by percentage in the years 18-19 and 19-20. So when speaking to the cost revenue, by our students enrolling in these AP courses, we earn extra funding. And that funding is used, of course, for a multitude of reasons. Mr. Springer can speak a bit more to that. However, take into consideration that the revenue we earn from our students being enrolled in an AP class will help us pay for the exams that they need to take, any trainings that their teachers need to attend in order to be able to provide them the best education possible, amongst many other things like supplies for our classes. Any questions so far?
Yes, I have one. This is Ray Lefevre.
Good morning.
Good morning. I'm wondering, are colleges accepting, I guess I would say, unlimited credits as freshmen coming in, or are some colleges still limiting the number of credits you can transfer in from high school?
There has been a limit in the past to the amount of credits that students can bring into college from AP or Cambridge. However, I believe the state mandated in the month of August that that limit can now be a combined amount of credits. And excuse me that the number eludes me at this time. I'm happy to provide it to you, but there is a limit for the amount. I believe that students cannot go past the degree, an AA degree in credits.
Okay, thank you.
Absolutely. So moving on to our Cambridge program, this program is from Cambridge International in England. We currently offer 19 courses and exams in any of the given series that the Cambridge Advanced International Education Program allows us to offer. In 2020, we entered 430 candidates or students for 1,401 exams. Many of our courses are split into an AS level and an A level, which essentially is just broken down into part one and part two. The rigor level increases over time. Our students earn pre-ACE or take pre-ACE courses as ninth graders to prepare them for 10th, 11th, and 12th grade. Up until this current state of emergency, Cambridge International mandated that our students earn these courses needed to get their diploma in under 25 months, which is why up until this point, our students must complete this in three consecutive years. We choose 10th, 11th, and 12th. This is the best opportunity for our students. We do expect that in the coming months that Cambridge and the state of Florida will reverse their decision outside of this 25-month period. They've given students some leeway because of this, but we do predict that it is going to go back to 25 months in the future. When students take seven classes and pass seven assessments, they earn 100% Bright Future scholarship to a Florida university, public university, which is awesome. But if the students are not on diploma track, which we do have some in our building that take individualized courses that are best for them, they can earn college credit for each course or assessment they take and pass. In order to earn that diploma, you must take seven credits, each in category or group one, two, and three, as well as courses offered in group four. A mandatory class is a course called Global Perspectives and Research that we offer to our students most predominantly in 11th grade. Here's just another list, an organization of our ACE course offerings as of this year. In the past year, we've been able to add an additional syllabus, media studies, and we are evaluating other syllabus that we can add to our course offerings each year for the future based on student need as well as personnel that are available. Here we have our pass rates for 2020. We had an incredibly successful year despite COVID-19 keeping us away from our physical classrooms. You can see here that our pass rate for our English AS level and our general paper AS, which are English courses, is 100%. We also had an incredibly high pass rate in Marine A level, which is the second section of Marine. Additionally, the remainder of the syllabus you can see here, 100% pass rate in our Physics A level, which is an incredibly rigorous course that our students take. We also had a wonderfully high pass rate for our A-level history course. You can see the very last one with the little diploma indicates that this global perspectives course, we had 96% pass rate, keeping in mind that this is the mandatory course for students to earn diploma. And the first time they took this assessment, took this course, 135 out of our 140 students were successful. This next slide simply shows a bit more data over the last 3 years. What's really wonderful is that because of our course offerings and our scheduling opportunities for our students, very frequently we see that juniors are able to earn their ACE diploma by the end of their junior year. meaning that they enter their senior year of high school here at Coral Springs Charter School, already having 100% Bright Future Scholarship and 7 or more credits that the college may accept instead of taking the introductory course that they may have to. In 2018 and 19, you can see that 70% of our junior applicants earned, meaning that as they entered their senior year in 2019 and 2020, they already had their ACE diploma. In 1920, we saw an increase of that 95% of our junior applicants earned their diploma, which is awesome. So that means that 63 students that are currently seniors in our building have already earned their 100% Bright Future Scholarship. 27% is what that equals out to, and 102 ACE diplomas were earned in the 2020 series that we just experienced in the May-June timeframe out of 113 applicants. Again, if you consider the amount of money, revenue that we have coming in from students that are taking these advanced courses, and you consider the amounts of cost there is for each of these exams. You can see here a breakdown for the last 3 years based on the number of students tested and the number of tests passed. You can see that we've had a great increase of number of tests passed over the last 3 years. And we continue to see that positivity rate in our students' pass rates and successes here at Coral Springs Charter School. Before I move on, are there any questions about ACE or the Cambridge International Program? Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and move on and speak to you about the career and technology education opportunities. These opportunities are available to our students beginning in middle school. The idea behind these career and technology education courses is that our students earn industry certification, which allows them to move forward with more advanced courses in their high school as long as they begin in their middle school, which is the benefit of having our 6-12 building. We see our students move through these programs all the way through. Prerequisite and industry certifications are offered in middle school, as I mentioned, and they do give students the high school credit and satisfy high school graduation requirements for technology education. There's two different types of scholarships that our students can earn when they do enroll in these digital information technology classes. Industry certification allows students to earn credits toward an AA degree. And this would be the second scholarship opportunity that our students would be able to earn. You can see here that we would like our students to achieve that 3.0 weighted core GPA and achieve a 3.5 unweighted GPA in pathway courses, specifically those CTE courses. They also need to meet a minimum for ACT, SAT, or CERT scores in order to qualify for that those scholarship opportunities. So again, just I'm going to back one more. Two different scholarship opportunities for our students that enroll in CTE courses. Some of the programs that we offer: business education in middle school, students are exposed to the Microsoft Office Specialist Industry Certification. In high school, you can see there's a plethora of opportunities for our students to go ahead and earn industry certification through Adobe, they learn web design, TV and motion picture, QuickBooks. We also have the opportunity for our technical education, career and technical education for our students to be exposed to a personal trainer opportunity, an ACSM certified personal training certificate. Here we can see the number of certifications passed in the last 3 years and the pass rate. We did see a bit of a difference due to COVID, but Mr. Springer, I believe you can speak to this a bit more, that our students were given the opportunity to achieve that industry certification over the summer. That's correct, Mr. Springer?
That is correct. So that number has changed, the 30% has changed dramatically since then. So we're grateful for that. We don't have numbers yet because we're still working through a cohort of students. We still have this semester to do that.
We're very proud of our students and our teachers for taking advantage of the opportunities that were given to them to earn those certifications during this time period. You can see the average enrollment per year. It fluctuates based on the amount of students that take the industry certification class in middle school. And again, just a revenue analysis for us to see the number of certifications help us to accrue a revenue, which of course we use to purchase licenses for the programs that our students are learning, as well as the cost of teacher bonuses that exist with a net revenue at the end. Any questions on CTE? Moving on to the ACE Academy, this is Mrs. Donahue's Opportunity Academy for her students and the students at Coral Springs Charter School to participate in the community by moving through an executive internship when they are seniors. This program became to be in the first year of Coral Springs Charter School in 1999. It provides our students with opportunities for enrichment programs where they can participate in community partnerships. There's a list right here of the opportunities that Ms. Hu is able to provide her students, such as Learn and Earn Saturdays and Career Days leadership workshops. She also hosts an ethics seminar for the senior class, which is a wonderful opportunity for our students. Approximately 400 or more than 400 graduates have participated in the executive internship program. The benefits of this executive internship program, our students are utilizing their time to have firsthand exposure to the real world. We're giving students the opportunity to put their knowledge to work and experience project-based learning in a professional environment. They're learning new skills and connecting with professionals that are going to help them develop the human relationships that we know exist in the real world. Communications, college and employability skills, which are so important. The expectation for our students walking into universities is much higher than it has been in the past. And so we like to see that they are learning college and workplace concepts in high school so they can become self-directed learners and they are engaged in a rigorous workplace. We also see that students that participate in these internships increase the chances of acceptance to college and university internships in the future. And they have open doors to major organizations that can identify they've participated in internship programs locally. Of course, we should consider the intrinsic value of participating in these programs. When students take the opportunity to participate in these internship programs, they're usually among the top 30% of the graduating class, and the average satisfaction of community partners that work with these students is 95%. We are excited to see that graduates prove themselves to be college and career ready. They have discipline and skills as well as maturity to succeed in the real world. As mentioned before, programs, college applications, are able to see that our students participate in these programs. It also allows our students to pursue a career that's meaningful to them because they've already had a real world experience in them. It's important to consider the fact that not only do colleges recognize these programs, but other workplaces identify that students have been able to have career opportunity at a young age. Mr. Springer, would you like me to play this video or we can send this to the board?
We can skip this for now. Guys, this is a great video, actually. I would love for you to get this and be able to listen to.
I'm happy to send this over independent of the PowerPoint. That way you can view. This is a former student of Ms. Donahue's speaking to his experience in the internship program. Wonderful.
If you send that to me, I'll send it out to the board.
So speaking to dual enrollment, which has been brought up over the past few weeks, and we've been speaking about this, of course, our summer 2020 data is skewed because of the changes of course offerings because of COVID-19. However, if we look at our 2019 data, we can see that 173 dual enrollment courses were taken by students at Coral Springs Charter School. So if we assume that on an average, students enroll in 100 courses per term during the fall and the spring, if we were to open this opportunity, we need to consider the cost. of this experience. If one credit is $71.98, and each course is typically three credits, we're spending about $215.94 per course for our students. If 100 courses are enrolled in, we're of course spending $21,594 per semester, plus the cost of textbooks, which can vary between about $6,000 to $8,000. And what we end up seeing is a total year increase of somewhere between $55,000 and $59,000 that we'd be spending in order to have our students participate in dual enrollment courses during the fall and the spring, as opposed to the summer alone. It's important to consider some factors that aren't numbers: the workload of the high school and the dual enrollment schedules combined. It's important to keep in mind that many of our students who participate in the dual enrollment program are also students that we see enrolled in our ACE and AP classes, incredibly rigorous courses with very difficult multi-part assessments at the end of the year. It's important to consider a student's maturity level. At some point, we need to consider if we can allow students to simply be students and be really, really amazing students at the high school level, and allow them the opportunity to take these college level courses through the ACE and AP programs. Any younger than what we're doing right now, 10th, 11th, and 12th grade, is something we do have a bit of a concern about. The effect on the college GPA, this was discussed at last week's meeting, keeping in mind that dual enrollment courses begin accruing GPA points towards a student's college GPA. If a student is unable to be successful for any particular reason, they carry that with them when they go to the next university that they are able to attend. This is different than our ACE and AP level courses. What this means is that when our students take our ACE and AP level courses and have the opportunity to earn their college credit, schools will see on their official high school transcripts that they've taken these courses, which is heavily weighted in decision making. If they pass the assessment and earn the credit, it's only positive for our students. If they take the assessment and do not earn a passing score, it doesn't hurt their college GPA in any way. We also have concerns about transportation to campus, our younger students, how are they going to get to their courses, and availability of the courses after our school hours. Of course, our students are here until 2:35 or in school until 2:35. And so depending on the course offerings that the college is able to give to our students during the fall and spring semesters, this may create a conflict for our students.
So real quick to weigh in, and as you had seen all of this, wow, you know, I mean, I'm hoping you're saying, wow, like this school does a lot. Every time I see this, I'm continually impressed, and I'm the principal here, and I know what we do. The crux of this is with regards to dual enrollment, and I know Ms. Heller is going to weigh in as well. The crux to this is we're at an impasse with our governing board with regards to whether or not dual enrollment should be offered throughout the school year. And for us at the school level leadership is of the thought process that we would like to maintain that ability to make those decisions and be able to continually work with our students, refine our programs, and be great at what we do. Whereas, you know, we're concerned by doing things or having to put into place stuff throughout the year that's really going to have a potential impact on our daily offerings, as Ms. Weisbaum had pointed out. So that's the decision or where we're at now, but I'll allow Ms. Heller to potentially weigh in a bit more before I, as I had assured the governing board, I would present this to you. So please, Ms. Heller, I don't know if at this point you want to say a few things.
Good morning. I would like to share my screen and walk through the presentation that I gave to the governing board over the last couple of weeks. Actually, it was last week, right, Gary? Let's go ahead and share the screen. All right, so you all are seeing the slide that says dual enrollment in advanced academic programs, correct?
Correct.
Okay, perfect. So, you know, every school wants to prepare their students regardless of their age for whatever comes next. And the whatever comes next varies from student to student somewhat widely. And this presentation is intended to educate you about opportunities to challenge our students and the pros and cons of some of those choices. Hang on, it's not letting me advance my slide. There we go. So an overview of what I'm going to cover. We're going to talk about dual enrollment. We're going to talk about alternatives to dual enrollment. We're going to have a comparison of nearby schools so we can see what else is in the area. And then, of course, I will turn it back over to the advisory board chair for discussion. Dual enrollment, this is the definition that's out of the Broward College's school counselor manual. I would like to highlight that it provides an opportunity for students to take post-secondary coursework and simultaneously earn high school and college credits, saving time and money. So it's that simultaneous earning of credits that dual enrollment is aimed at. Dual enrollment basics. Dual enrollment is available at all Broward County high schools. The options for enrollment are obviously online. Online offerings can be taken. Students can go to a Broward College facility, and some high schools offer dual enrollment courses actually on their campus taught by one of their instructors. This requires an existing teacher at the school to be credentialed to teach that college level course, and Broward College does not provide any compensation for that teacher.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
What percent of the dual enrollment classes are taught on campus at the charter school?
I do not believe there's any dual enrollment classes taught on campus at charter. Is that correct?
Yes, that is correct. We do not offer cross-curricular. We try not to impede on what the dual enrollment offerings are for our students so they don't have double credits in the end.
Thank you.
You're welcome. For grade reporting, dual enrollment courses are required to be disclosed on the high school transcript by state law, and which means that all dual enrollment coursework is disclosed at college admission time. Dual enrollment classes are weighted the same as the Cambridge ACE or an AP class, and that is on a 6.0 scale. Dual enrollment at Broward College. This is specific to the offerings at Broward College. It's available to students, public, private, charter schools, as well as homeschool students. Meeting GPA test score requirements as well as continued enrollment requirements. So there's one set of requirements to be admitted to be allowed to take a dual enrollment course, and then there are ongoing requirements that the student must meet in order to continue to be able to enroll. The enrollment requirements are an unweighted high school GPA of at least 3.0. The reality of this is that if a student takes a high school class in sixth grade, by the time that semester grade is issued in, around December, January, the next registration period for dual enrollment does not happen until summer. So the summer following sixth grade is the earliest time that a student can enroll in a dual enrollment class. It also requires college level test scores in English reading and math. This chart shows a high level of the options, SAT, ACT, PERT, and the ACCUPLACER. The student scores need to be above these thresholds for for every part of the test. So it's not like you can pick and choose where you've got an acceptable score in English on the SAT and you've got reading that you're doing on the ACT. You can't mix and match like that. So these are the scores that a student needs to have to meet the dual enrollment threshold. Now the continued eligibility for dual enrollment, approved dual enrollment recommendation form. This form has a couple of important things on it. It needs to be signed in advance of each term, so it needs to be continuously done throughout the student's high school career. Needs to be signed by the student, parent, guardian, school counselor, and principal. Student needs to maintain a 3.0 unweighted high school GPA and a 2.0 GPA at Broward College. Students need to earn a C or better in each course. So while it says you need to maintain a 2.0 GPA, the fact of the matter is, with a C, you will not be allowed to enroll in further courses, even if with the C, your GPA is higher. We've already talked about some of the financial aspects of dual enrollment. There is no cost to students for dual enrollment, whether it's during the summer or during the school year. Students eventually enrolling in state university system, the courses will count towards your degree requirements. So you are getting, two requirements worth out of one class. For Coral Springs Charter School students, there's obviously the conversation about impact on per student revenue from the state, which is a discussion that we've had. But beyond that, the school does pay for books and course materials. And as was discussed by Ms. Weisbaum, there is a cost for tuition during the school year. During the summer, there is not a cost for tuition, but the school does pay for books and course materials regardless of the time of year. So it is no cost to the student with the school picking up the cost.
Can I clarify something here?
Sure.
If you go back, the impact on student revenue from the state, my understanding is that a bill was passed and signed by the governor that once a student completes the class, that the state will actually reimburse the school for those FTE dollars, even if a student were to leave campus, based upon the students completing the course.
Okay.
If I may, so I did review that bill and I spoke with Florida Department of Education. And keep in mind, what Florida Department of Education tells you compared to what the county tells you, compared to what the rule actually says, is different at literally every level. The bill that was passed that you're referencing, Commissioner Vignola, is that you're correct that it does say that, and in addition, there's incentives for students who actually perform well. According to the statute, there's additional FTE that's awarded. According to DOE, there is in fact no reduction in FTE for a student that is duly enrolled. And the reason for that is because, according to the Department of Education, is that the school is responsible for paying for the tuition, which is exactly why they would need to get the full FTE to pay for that. Now, of course, it's different every single time you look at it. The legislature says one thing. Florida Department of Education passes a rule. The senior analyst or whatever at the Florida Department of Education has his opinion on it. It gets filtered down to the school board. They have their own opinion on it. It's an administrative nightmare. So what the bill says versus how it is in practicality changes depending on what the Florida Education Commission votes. So just wanted to make that clarification.
Thank you very much, Andrew. Additional questions on this? Okay. Dual enrollment at public middle schools, this is something that the governing board had also discussed. The enrollment process that we described a couple slides ago requires reviewing each student's unique circumstances during the admissions process, obviously with the sign off of the parents, the principals, and the guidance counselor. That big picture view is maintained during the review process. Per Broward College, in the last 7 years, less than 10 middle school students have dual enrolled, and there are currently no dual enrolled middle school students. Now, the upside of dual enrollment in middle school is that dual enrollment classes, as I mentioned, are on the same 6.0 scale that AP and Cambridge ACE are. So that does provide the students with an opportunity to take GPA boosting classes earlier. The downside, which is the same for dual enrollment at any grade, is a D or an F precludes a student from taking another dual enrollment class for the rest of his or her high school career. And eventually, if that student attends a state college or university, that grade earned in the class does count towards the student's college GPA. So, and that is the same, again, for dual enrollment at any grade. Dual enrollment at other charter schools. Other charter schools have their own rules about how dual enrollment is handled and utilized by its students. Pembroke Pines Charter School requires all of its students to take all of their classes on campus. As a result, students can take one of the few classes that they offer, few dual enrollment classes that they offer on campus as part of their normal schedule and normal course load. Students wanting to take any other dual enrollment courses not offered at the school must do so on their own time, and that would make that class in addition to their normal course load. Somerset 9th and 10th graders are allowed to take dual enrollment classes, but they need to be taken on the student's own time. And 11th and 12th graders can leave early to take dual enrollment classes if they've already passed two AP ACE exams, continue to be enrolled in AP or ACE coursework, and they take two dual enrollment classes simultaneously. Now, in this case, the student can go to a Broward College location, or they can take those classes online. So what happens when your dual enrollment to your dual enrollment credits when you go to an out-of-state school? You know, and again, this is part of the larger pros and cons conversation. You know, charter grads have recently been accepted at Columbia, Harvard, Brown, and Penn. Dual enrollment classes are taken into account as a part of the student's GPA, as a part of the overall level of rigor of their coursework during the college admissions process, but the credits are generally not transferable. And you see here listed pretty clearly that these universities do not take credit for, they do not give you transfer credits towards graduation for anything that you took that applied to your high school, also met graduation requirements for your high school diploma. Now, that doesn't mean that they won't see that you have an A, say in, you know, calculus 101, and say, okay, you've met the prerequisite requirements, and then you start in calculus 102. So that's just an example there. But as far as the transfer credit aspect of it, dual enrollment credits do transfer within the Florida university system, but outside that, they may not.
So based off of that, they won't accept credit taken before they graduated from high school. AP and Cambridge also would not count towards the college credit of those schools.
Correct. Okay. Absolutely correct. But they would be counted towards the GPA, and they'd also be counted towards the you know, the level of rigor, the difficulty that the student took in terms of their course load.
Of course.
So in that manner, they're kind of all the same.
the only caveat to that is that's not actually the case, because AP is not the same as Broward College. So I would think, and or Cambridge, in most instances, in particular these universities, they would consider those courses at a much higher level.
If I may, we shared last week, Mrs. Heller, with Ms. Pepe, our guidance director here, that when colleges look at transcripts, they are looking to see that students have exposed themselves to the rigorous opportunities that the College Board Advanced Placement courses and the ACE courses provide to them. And they look more strongly upon those opportunities than they do at the dual enrollment that the students take. In many cases, whereas courses are not accepted for credits at universities that you've listed here. In some cases, these universities will acknowledge the AP and the ACE credits because they are such a rigorous level of study. Not all, but many.
Okay. This is Ray Lefevre again. I concur with that as a one-time guidance director at Cooper City High School. That it, I agree with that statement that it is, it does impact their assessment process by the colleges.
Okay. Well, we're going to talk about advanced placement and Cambridge ACE in just a minute. So if there's no other questions at this time, I'm going to go on to the next slide. Quick summary of dual enrollment pros and cons. We have talked about most of this. I think the one thing that maybe we haven't discussed directly is that the dual enrollment courses could provide access to a college level class that isn't offered in AP or Cambridge. Broward College maintains a list of 48 frequently taken courses. Certainly, there's a much broader course catalog available to students if they were, you know, considering dual enrollment. But that does compare to the 19 Cambridge and 9 AP. So I did want to highlight that. Two alternatives to dual enrollment at Coral Springs Charter, and you've obviously already heard a lot about these options already this morning. There's 9 advanced placement courses available, 19 Cambridge ACE courses available. In terms of, we've already talked about enrollment and the number of students taking each class. So in the interest of time, I'm gonna go ahead and move on to the next slide. Advanced placement, this is, a more popular alternative to dual enrollment because they're more widely, though not universally accepted. AP classes are weighted the same as dual enrollment or ACE Cambridge, so they are a GPA booster, and students can take AP courses beginning in 10th grade. The chart I've got here highlights that the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 rating scale is not a guarantee that you will get credit. You know, you'll see on the right side, and this is from the Princeton Review, that if you get a 5 on a score, you know, will you receive AP credit? Usually, it depends on the university. But again, it can be a substitute for meeting a prerequisite class, allowing you to take a more advanced class initially. So you are getting something out of that at the college level, but again, that's similar to, potentially similar to dual enrollment. Cambridge ACE, obviously, again, we've already talked about this a little bit, but I did want to read the description that's on Cambridge's website. It says Cambridge Advanced is typically for learners aged 16 to 19 years who need advanced study to prepare for university and higher education. Broward County School Board's Advanced Academic Programs Comparison Chart includes that it offers the students the opportunity to tailor their studies to the individual interests, abilities, and future plans with an international curriculum. I'm going to skip ahead here. Internationally renowned special diploma recognized by colleges and universities all over the world. Again, that's from the Broward County School Board's advanced enrollment options materials. Cambridge ACE classes are weighted the same as dual enrollment, so they are a GPA booster, again, on that 6.0 scale. Students can take Cambridge ACE beginning in 10th grade, as has been discussed. But students do not need to be pursuing the Cambridge ACE degree in order to enroll in those classes, which I'm not sure if that was mentioned earlier, so I wanted to make sure to highlight that. So summarizing advanced placement in Cambridge ACE, pros and cons, you know, many of the pros are similar. They both are on a GPA 6.0 GPA scale. They both look favorable on a college application. You know, for AP, you may be able to get some credit, you may not. On the Cambridge side, the degree automatically provides 100% Bright Futures scholarship regardless of GPA or SAT ACT course, which is a huge benefit. Now, moving on to the cons, advanced placement, you know, the opportunity for college credit depends entirely upon a student's exam grade. So you sit for one exam, and that determines whether or not you're eligible for college credit, if your college will consider it, for that entire year's worth of work. And it's down to one test. And I will tell you from my personal experience, my daughter is a junior this year. She took two AP classes last year because of COVID. Neither of those tests were the same as what she had been practicing for all year. They were obviously given online, which again is very different than what they've prepared for. And, you know, she has on her transcript the benefit of showing that she enrolled in an AP class and what her grades were throughout the year. But she's not going to be eligible to receive credit anywhere because that exam was, you know, not what really she had been prepared for. So it's, you know, chalk it up to COVID. But the point is that that one test is very, very important with AP. Now the cons of Cambridge ACE, again, college may not apply credits towards graduation requirements. That's pretty much the same for advanced placement. But again, you may get the ability to say you've met a prerequisite and take a more advanced class. Selecting the best option for each student, and really, you know, the pros and cons of this, when to enroll in dual enrollment instead of AP or Cambridge ACE or IB, really depends entirely upon the student and what their objectives are in choosing those classes. You know, your first choice school is what they can, what they accept, what they don't accept is something that could be important, but the odds of a freshman in high school knowing what their first choice school is, you know, that sometimes doesn't quite work out, although some students do know what that is and can make those choices with those requirements in mind. So this quote is just to highlight that for different students, different options are better. Why am I not advancing? There we go. This is my last slide here. This looks at a number of public schools in our area. This was information requested by our governing board. All schools offer advanced placement dual enrollment classes. The school grade, which is the first column you see on the left, The grades are from the 19 school year. Grades, of course, were not issued at the end of last school year because of COVID. We've got graduation rates. Cambridge is a new offering at Coral Springs High School and JP Taravella this year. We've put some ranking information in here for Broward and Florida, along with the overall AP exam pass rate. So this is for your information. Any questions on this? Seeing none.
All right. Thank you all so much. And thank you to Amy. Thank you, Ms. Heller. Amy, I'm going to pass it back to you because I know there's just a short statement. We'll keep it in the interest of time, but just about next steps, because I know that within your position, and with regards to us always working with Charter Schools USA and continually trying to push ourselves, what want to share that with the board, because this is, hasn't been, we just did this the other day, actually, some of this.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Springer. So now that we've seen some of the information presented for all of these programs, you know, kind of behind the scenes, what we're working to is providing as many opportunities as we can for our students to be successful here. We are exploring opportunities for our students to earn those college level credits through other means, expanding the programming that we do offer. We're constantly, as I mentioned earlier, looking at the course offerings for both ACE and AP. Advanced placement courses that can be included in our course offerings here at Coral Springs Charter, and exploring how we can give more opportunities for our students, especially those high performing students that these courses, ACE and AP, appeal to in order to earn that, that 100% bright features, those credits. I think it's important in the grand scheme of everything to recognize that while there are some schools that may not accept the dual enrollment or the AP or the ACE, that, you know, as Mrs. Heller mentioned, first choice schools, not many freshmen know what that is in 3.5, 4 years from that point in time. So it's a great positive and something we want to be able to provide to our students, that if they do intend to attend a Florida State University, that these are the colleges and universities that do accept these credits with comprehensive lists of how they apply. That being said, our experience last week as we met as a team was to be able to look into how we can provide, as I mentioned, additional opportunities and additional course offerings for our students here to be able to take them forward and potentially earn those college level credits later on.
Sorry, I muted myself. So some of you are like, okay, what was this all about, Gary? What do we have to do, or what are we expected to do? As I mentioned before, at this point, you know, from the position where I sit, I wanted to provide you a comprehensive view, and I believe we did so. And I'm asking, you know, that we're of the position to maintain the dual enrollment offerings that we currently offer, which are in the summer. We've expanded that. We've discussed that to our governing board, with allowing that for students rolling it into their, or after their eighth grade year, rolling into their ninth grade year over the summer. And moving forward, we're requesting that this board continues to provide school level leadership the ability to make these decisions with regards to our advanced programming offerings. We're seeking that to be a recommendation to the governing board. That's my position on this, and that's what I'm petitioning you for.
Okay, so can I please get a motion to recommend the advanced placement and dual enrollment for further discussion?
Well, that's actually not what we're seeking. So that's happened, which is why let me clarify with everybody. What's been going on back and forth is the governing board has been seeking that we offer dual enrollment during the spring and fall semesters, or fall and spring semesters. And we've, to the point of where we feel as if we're offering such a comprehensive program that we literally, the wise individuals that even came before me had the foresight to begin to establish Cambridge And Cambridge has been and is our foundational program of this school. Whereas if we extend beyond, we're of the position that we would like to not be, have to offer the fall and spring semesters. But it's certainly, you know, up to this board in discussion, if you wish to make a recommendation that would be different from the position as to where the school leadership is on this. So that's where we're at. And that's why we wanted to present this to you, because we wanted you to be able to see that outside of just dual enrollment, there's a whole lot going on that our kids are able to take and have the ability to, and we're continually revising that. And that's, you know, what I think this boils down to is, at what point does the board, you know, trust the leadership to make those wise decisions for the best benefit of the school and the students? And I think that you have tons of context, which is why I wanted it to come back to this board, because this board consists of parents. This board consists of educational experts. Ray, you mentioned many of your positions that you've sat in with regards to the school board of Broward County. So I think that's why I wanted it to come back down to this team to be able to, you know, make a recommendation to our governing board, either for dual enrollment or to maintain the local decision-making with regards to the school leadership.
Okay. I think if I can clarify, the question that I believe the governing board was looking for is year-round dual enrollment versus in the summer, in the current model you're offering. You have offered to make it available beginning in the summer after eighth grade, which I think is a good option for students that qualify. I think having that more options is sometimes better than having fewer options. But I think from the governing board's perspective, the primary question was the offering throughout the school year in addition to the summer. And that, from my perspective, is what is the question that needs to be answered. And I appreciate Principal Springer's, you know, comments on the local decision making. But I believe the question the governing board was asking was specifically related to the timing of the dual enrollment option.
Okay, so before we vote, if I could just give my input as a parent. Of my daughter that graduated with Cambridge diploma, with so much work that she put into it. And I get emotional. She's my oldest and my baby, but second year of college, 100% free, bright futures. And I mean, it's great for dual enrollment, like I said, but I think I'm so thankful for Charter for having the Cambridge classes and working with kids so hard for them to get that. To me, it just seems like they put so much work into it for the staff and for the students that, and it gives them basically, if they do get the Cambridge diploma, it gives them 100% bright future. So, to me personally, as a parent, it not that it doesn't make sense to have both, but if you do get the bright futures, it's really, you could take classes for free. And so basically, okay, so.
And we're not suggesting any of those options go away.
No. It's just that it's extra work and extra input for the school. Go ahead.
So if I may clarify on one point to that, in addition, Ms. Van Helden, as well, I know, you know, aside from the 100% bright future, she also transferred a ton of credits into college as well, thankfully. But on top of that,
your teacher's not on.
No, she is.
Sorry.
Okay, well then go sit and listen to.
Sorry. On top of that, with regards to potentially, what we would consider overlapping throughout the year with regards to dual enrollment. What will happen is it, you know, in particular, if this especially is to be recommended for it to happen during the school day and students to leave early, this is going to potentially, or it will literally eliminate opportunities throughout the school day schedule, because we're not a huge school. Let's stop and start there, right? We're not a huge school when we talk about high schools. So we don't have like 10 sections of a Cambridge subject. So if there's something that's only offered in the afternoon, and it's not, there's not going to be an option or an opportunity for us to really work through that or change up our schedule. I go back to saying, and as you just mentioned, we have put so much time, we're talking decade, over a decade into this, 15 years, quite honestly, into creating and building this program into what it is, that it'll be very difficult to manage those individuals that would choose to potentially take dual enrollment in the fall and spring. That's the only position I'm from. You know, whether or not we do or don't at this point in time, I don't really want to get into the weeds on that anymore. I just want this board to, per Mrs. Heller, that was the question at the last board meeting, and I respectfully requested that this board, as per protocol, have the opportunity to make or not make that recommendation.
Gary, can I ask a question? This is Ray again. I don't know if you know the answer, but most of the dual enrollment that I was familiar with, they were actually, those courses were, most of them were actually taught on the high school campus.
Correct.
So one of the considerations that I have also are, like you're saying, if you leave during the school day, you eliminate the courses that the school is off, the high school is offering. And, you know, I was always comfortable with dual enrollment kids taking that class on my high school campus, as opposed to those kids, number one, traveling to a college and being involved in the whole college situation there. I was a little more uncomfortable with that.
Yeah, you and I share the exact same sentiments, and that's the point. That's why we have the amount of Cambridge courses, because, you know, it's equitable, quite honestly, if not to a greater degree with Cambridge, because it leads to a potential diploma, and has like an end. And there's also, you know, I go back to where you're at, right? You lose control. And I don't mean like, you know, I just mean you lose control though, or oversight of the students when they're not on your campus.
Right. So I guess to summarize, I would make a motion or support a motion. It sounds like Charter Schools USA wants to be more specific. So I guess, am I saying I would make a motion that we would continue with offering the dual enrollment option to students during the summertime only?
Hey, this is Phil Bill. Can I get a chance to ask a question before you put a motion up there? Cool. My question is this, because you've already mentioned that like a bunch of seniors already have their Cambridge diploma. Why not offer, again, it would be on their own time, or if you could work it out that you could have a campus, have at least the seniors that want to take something that's not offered in the Cambridge system at the campus now, the ability to take a class at Broward, because you already got the Cambridge diploma at that point. I mean, you could, you said like 65 kids or something like that have, or 65 children, excuse me, already have their Cambridge diploma for the seniors this year. Why not give give them a chance to do a Broward College class instead of just saying, hey, you got the choice of the 19 plus 9 is 28 college level offerings already. What if they don't, what if that doesn't meet their requirement or what they're trying to do or look at as a, in their college future, but Broward College might have a class that different from what outside of what's already offered. Instead of saying, hey, I got what you're doing with ACE. My son's in the ACE program, and I tell you what, it's a great system. I love it. With that said, I'm maybe just seniors to see, again, as a test to see how, what, first off, what's the people looking even to try to even consider doing that. But that would be a small subset of children. And I think because that would be a good subset, because you already know, because they got the ACE diploma, they're good students. They probably have the right GPA and everything else. And giving them the opportunity to advance their academic career.
Yeah, so that's been our latest discussion with regards to that. And we're hopeful that those would be, and just to kind of give you the other side of it and what we've been thinking, because that decision we're not going to obviously be able to make right now, Mr. Balin, but that would be the group that we're looking to be our ACE capstone students on top of that. So, you know, this is a program that we're looking to infuse over the next few years, you know, starting with our freshmen potentially or 10th graders. And then by that point in time, yeah, they would be, since they achieve an ACE diploma during their junior year, they'd obviously still have the opportunity to take ACE and Cambridge synonymous, sorry. And then also potentially some additional AP courses that would allow them to achieve an ACE capstone, which is—
Madam Chair?
The other question I have is, you guys know what the classes are that the children are taking at the dual enrollment. Have you considered maybe making that, if this is possible, making that an ACE offering? This way you still stay within the ACE system, and but it also meets the students' needs if they're already at the level.
You were kind of breaking out, so I'm thinking my internet might be the one that's a little funky right now.
Mr. Springer, I believe I understood what Mr. Balaam's saying, if I may. Mr. Balaam, there are more course offerings available from the Cambridge International Program within limits, and they don't always equate to the same types of courses that the dual enrollment program offers. It's important, I believe we also said this earlier, that we're not double dipping with our students, and so when looking at the dual enrollment course list, as much as there's more options per se, we need to make sure that one, they're not, you know, double dipping, as we said, and two, that the course that they're choosing to enroll in is appropriate maybe for whatever grade level they're in. So even if we're choosing to offer the dual enrollment program earlier to incoming freshmen, which is, I believe, what has been mentioned, it's also a maturity level, an age level appropriate. So that's something to take into consideration as well.
No, I understand. I was thinking for school year dual enrollment, just seniors for now, just to see how it even works.
Madam Chair?
Go ahead.
Yeah, so this conversation really came about from me. You know, we're the families that choose Coral Springs Charter School choose it because, and the reason why we have charter schools is for school choice, for more options, right? And so this has been a discussion going back probably about 8 or 9 years with me and different families throughout the community. And it's kind of been a little bit of a back and forth or whatever. You know, the cost savings of dual enrollment to families is tremendous. When you talk about families that might not necessarily be able to afford sending their kid to college, a kid would have the opportunity to take dual enrollment classes at no cost to them during the school year instead of getting another job to pay for college and being able to focus on their studies. You know, one of the things I think that's important, the difference between dual enrollment and AP and Cambridge. And look, I think it's great that we offer AP and Cambridge. And I think a lot of families choose Coral Springs Charter because of that Cambridge program and that ACE diploma and the benefits with that. But, you know, with those types of courses, there's a lot of pressure on students for the exams, a lot of pressure. And I think you saw that 77% of AP students at Charter were not passing that AP exam compared to the other schools in the area. And that, you know, when you go take a class, whether it be online or in person at Broward College, the quality of instruction should be a little bit higher than what you would see at the high school level. The available classes for the students are much greater, and the variety of classes at a college, be it online or in person, than that a school, especially a school the size of Coral Springs Charter. We're not talking about Cypress Bay and 5,000 kids. There's only so much availability that they can offer and be able to provide a schedule. And this would help supplement that. You know, as far as the funding and stuff goes, you know, the $55,000 to $59,000 estimate that you saw presented, you know, we spend a lot of money on a lot of other programs and things for the school, whether it be sports or arts or whatever, and not to take away from those. And I'm not trying to say anything bad about those programs. I think those are wonderful and those are great opportunities for the students. But I think, you know, in the grand scheme of things, a cost like that is not too tremendous. And I have a feeling that the city of Coral Springs would be able to probably meet in the middle and cover that half of that cost of funding. That's something that we could discuss with the city manager's office and eventually the board. You know, if kids are given the option to leave campus early, there is also the option of bringing some more kids into charter to fill those spaces. If 30 kids were to leave and do half days, well, 15 more kids can come in. There'd actually be a net revenue to the city, to the school at that point. You know, and then look, the real world experience was spoken about quite a bit, a little bit earlier. And I know we talk about real world experience at the college level. I mean, what better way than to do that? You know, I know we say as a school, you know, well, I guess there's an agreement in place where we have all these dual enrollment classes available from 6th to 12th, and that's our contract with Broward College that we're currently not meeting. You know, when we go ahead and kids go and try to get into these types of colleges, a lot of times they look at what classes are available to you. So when you look at the availability of classes to students at Coral Springs Charter versus other schools, that gives you kind of a comparison. The fact that we do have dual enrollment listed as available to kids. However, the kids that are only able to take it during the summer, when we look at some kids that have to work over the summer to help provide and maybe save up for college, we look at families that take family vacations and take that opportunity to go ahead and do that. Or, you know, then there was also the split family homes where, okay, well, mom lives in Coral Springs, but dad lives in Tennessee, and the kid now has to go spend the summer with his father out in another state or whatever. It really limits what's available to kids, and I'm afraid that that's hurting some kids, you know, especially those that are financially challenged and those that come from split family homes. You know, my preference is that we go ahead and we were to offer this again, because, you know, here's charter schools came about because offering choices and options and being in favor of that for families to make educational decisions, you know, for your child, for your student. And that's kind of what this conversation came about is this something that we want to offer to give a choice, to give another option, another tool in the toolbox to benefit the students of Coral Springs Charter School. And again, it's not to take away from AP or the Cambridge program.
Thank you, Commissioner Pinola.
Madam Chair?
Go ahead, Mrs. Springer.
I could pretty much rebut many of the points that the commissioner had brought up, but I'm really not going to go back and forth. I'm asking this board to trust me as the instructional leader of this school to make these types of decisions. Talk about financial stability and challenged individuals. We have one of the highest Bright Futures rates in the county, if not maybe the highest. With regards to allocating dollars, we're discussing potentially changing things with regards to contracts and things like that. That's not appropriate, and it wouldn't be moving funds. And I don't want to have to make decisions on whether other programs in this school should be cut in order to offer a small amount of individuals or potentially a large amount, depends on how you open it up. And then in 11 years, as being the principal, not a single child has ever come to me and talked about them not being able to take a dual enrollment course in the summer. That's never, ever come up. So I just, without getting into any more of the points, I'm just seeking for this board to trust me as the principal to move forward and make these decisions for the academic success of all of our children.
I just want to clarify something here. So the Bright Future thing, if a student would still be able to take Cambridge classes and get their Bright Futures along with take other classes through dual enrollment, which would still save them even more money. And no one's saying to cut programs. The Charter Schools USA as a company makes, I believe this year, about $850,000 in profit from the city of Coral Springs as a company. So what I'm saying is I'm asking that by looking at this financially, maybe there's an opportunity for the city of Coral Springs to go ahead and kick in some of the money to help you offer that program for the students in spirit of, you know, school choice and options. It's not asking to cut any programs or anything like that. Like I said, there is a large profit margin there. And I imagine that the city of Coral Springs would be willing to work with you to help fund or finance that. I don't think that's something that's unreasonable.
Yeah, that's fair. And I appreciate that. But the one thing that's not fair is to call it a profit. The money that's given under contract for Charter Schools USA is literally to provide operational support for the success of this school. And quite honestly, if anything, we're underfunded with regards to our contract. So just an FYI, I mean, I don't know, the profit in and of itself and utilizing that term is not accurate. And being a part of this organization for, you know, over 18 years, I'm proud to say I think we've done a really good job managing the money, especially for this school. I think I've always been a very good steward of ensuring all of that. I understand, listen, and I respect everything that you 100% say. And I, you know, at the end of this, we're gonna speak because I know this is your last meeting with us. But at the end of this, you know, obviously I'll share some words and sentiments, but with regards to this specific issue, I believe it's now into the hands of the board to make a decision. And if you certainly have questions of me, board, I'll be here to answer.
Thank you, Mr. Springer. So do we as a board, can we vote which option we want, or do we basically just make a motion to keep the dual enrollment just over the summer the way it is now and vote on that?
I believe the motion was made already.
Right, I was just gonna say, Ray made the motion to keep the dual enrollment as it currently is. And then for the minutes, the purpose is the question before the board is to keep the dual enrollment as it is with the principal or school leadership making those decisions. That's the recommendation.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Rita. Brad?
Okay, I wanna clarify though.
Okay.
It makes the school leadership making those decisions. Help me understand what you mean by that.
Well, what I heard the question was that this board is going to recommend that we keep the programming the way it currently is. And then what I also heard the ask of the board was that as it has been for 18 years, Gary, school leadership has, with this board's collaboration, made those recommendations. If I misheard that, then somebody can correct me, but that is what I heard the question being asked.
Certainly, not only does the advisory board, but the governing board relies upon Charter Schools USA to make recommendations on curriculum changes and appropriate adjustments, not only given, you know, the environment, but as the field of education evolves, as additional options become available, we certainly look to our operator for those recommendations to educate the advisory board as well as the governing board on what's out there and pros and cons to the extent that it's something that the governing board wishes to weigh in on. So I would like to try to keep the motion for today, if possible, specific to right now with respect to dual enrollment, its current offerings, which I believe is the motion, that the current offerings be continued in the manner they're being offered, that is this board's recommendation and advice to the governing board, or if you recommend or advise changes. Does that make sense?
Can I ask one more question before we do this?
Sure.
Can I ask one more question? What's the demand for, or has it been there, or is there demand for kids, children asking for during the year classes? Or is this just something that is just being on the higher level asking for? Is there a demand from the children, or is this a trying to, the governing board trying to expand the what Coral Springs offers?
I'll speak to that. I've spoken to Broward College a couple times where I've heard that it has been asked of them, and they cannot allow it to students. So even if a student wants to take it during the school year, and they offer to pay for the classes themselves, because of the contract that Mr. Springer entered into with Broward College, they cannot do that. Over the years, I've had numerous kids ask me directly if we could do that and why doesn't charter school offer that. And I've had a few families as well over the years.
Okay, so the demand is not exactly pounding on the door heavy.
I can't imagine more than a dozen or so kids taking advantage of the program. But again, if that were to happen, that's a dozen kids that would be able to have their needs met.
Okay, thank you.
If I can just speak to that, having just lived through that, my daughter Nicole graduated class of 2019 with a Cambridge diploma and is now at FSU. And I know that for her and her friends, at one point it was an issue that they couldn't do enrollment earlier at charter. And just from hearing all those kids talking and stuff like that, a lot of them it was more of a status thing because their friends were doing it and they thought it was cool to be part of, you know, college and all of that while it's still in high school. So just to add another side of things. I mean, that was something that was discussed here at home because she wanted to transfer out and all of that. But we, of course, kept her at charter. And now that she's in her sophomore year and we go back and talk about it, she's glad that she stayed there at charter, finished out her high school there, and that she didn't push to do the dual enrollment as much. I mean, she did do it that her junior year that summer. She took some classes at DC, but it really wasn't from her and her friends. It really was more of a, you know, to be in college earlier because they were already looking at their senior year. So just throwing that out there.
Okay. Thank you, Maria.
Thank you.
Okay, so if there's no any other questions or discussions, we'll go ahead with the motion. We had a motion and we had a second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay.
Aye.
Thank you. I believe the motion has passed. Is there
I have apologized. I have to leave. I have another meeting that started at 10 o'clock. Wish everybody a wonderful day, and I'm sorry I do have to run.
Thank you, Commissioner.
All right,
excuse me, this is Anne-Marie. Could you please tell me who did Mr. Lefevre make the motion and who made the second?
Brad seconded.
I'm sorry,
Brad seconded the motion.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And it passed. Thank you. Do we have any old business? Any old business? No. Okay. Thank you, everyone. I would like
to have a closing comment and potentially Ms. Heller as well, but I know I have a closing comment. Unfortunately, the commissioner had to leave the meeting, but this is being recorded, so you can look back on this one day. I just want to say thank you. I've known Larry Vignola for quite some time now with respect to an individual as a commissioner, vice mayor at one point in time, as well as an individual who obviously has his children at our school, and I'm very thankful for that. He's at many times has revealed that. So that's not something that I'm putting out there that hasn't been shared before. Over the time, you know, we have grown to have a level of respect for each other. COVID has you know, caused some ups and downs in the relationship, but it does not take away for his commitment to the city of Coral Springs, and in particular, his care for education in general within the city of Coral Springs. I really appreciate him, and I just want to say that publicly, and I know this board does as well. And as we say goodbye to Larry, we, you know, soon will be informed as to who our next liaison will be for this board, but thank you so much. And I just wanted to say that to the city of Coral Springs. Thank you for providing us the opportunity to work with Mr. Vignola. And thank you to the city of Coral Springs for their leadership as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Springer. Any other questions, comments? If not, I would like to adjourn the meeting at 10:14 a.m. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Stay thank healthy. You.
Have a great day. Thank you.
Bye, everybody.